Well, it always depends on what is your promise. I mean, the promise of the World Economic Forum is help to improve the state of the world. I think in this respect, this claim, the World Economic Forum has been living up to it. Has it been performing sufficiently? Has it been able to help to solve all the problems? No, I don't think so. Because this is such a vast challenge that one single institution cannot do it. But had it been helpful, many of the issues to be, first of all, discussed, and secondly, being brought up to the attention of the world public opinion, yes. And a very good example is the water issue. When it came to my mind that for the sustainability, first of the company I'm chairing, but secondly also for humankind, the most important issue is water. Well, I used the forum of Davos in order to speak about this subject. And I can tell you the first meeting about 4 years ago, there were about 10 people in the room who were interested into this subject. Well, if you have been this year to Davos, you would have seen that there were several major, major dialogues going on. And today, if I look at the media, I can see now a higher level of recognition of water being the issue that we have to tackle than perhaps climate change, which I think is absolutely right. I have said before, we will be running out of water long before we are running out of oil. And so I think in this sense, a forum like Davos helps enormously to identify new issues which are critical for the world, but also to help and to work in how we can find solutions. For example, in the case of water, the World Economic Forum has then created a global agenda group where we have more than 25 universities being united, and where we are now talking about what are the solutions to this problem and can propose to governments concrete action steps in order to help to solve those problems. So in this sense, I think this has been very helpful, and I think the World Economic Forum has a major role to play in helping to improve the state of the world. I don't think that there is one institution alone that can be up to this challenge that water means, because there is one fundamental and crucial difference between, for example, CO2 and water. You see, if let's suppose today we decide, you and me, that we are not emitting 1 kilo of CO2 into the air. We have made our small impact. But if you and me decide today that we will not take a shower in Switzerland in the morning, we have not solved the problem of the water in the Sahel region, in the Punjab region, in China, and in the region in Midwest of the USA. Contrary to the CO2, where you can have and you have to have a global view on the problem, in the case of the water, in order really to solve this problem, it can only be solved on a local or regional basis. And to make things worse, it is on this local and regional basis, in most cases, it is a not one nation solution, it's a several nation solution. I mean, if you look at the one of the most politically delicate aspects of the Middle East, is a water supply for Israel, Jordan, Syria, and Palestine. Not one of those countries can solve its water problem alone. If they are not working together, if they do not understand there's one water basin and how we are using this water in all its aspects, from the moment it comes to Earth, how we put it, how we keep it, how we use it, how we bear it with each other, etc., well, you cannot solve this problem. And that's a difficulty with the water. Well, I think That's a very, very crucial question. And it is being brought forward by some NGOs in a very simplistic manner. They are saying water is a human right. Therefore, it's not a commercial material. My answer to this is, yes, you're right. Water is a human right. The 25 liters of water that we need as a minimum as a person in order to live decently, which is my 4 to 5 liters of liquid which I have to take to me, which is about the 4 or 5 liters for the cleaning. It's about the 4 or 5 liters that we need in order to clean the dishes. Yes, this is a human right. But I don't think it's a human right to fill up my swimming pool, to wash my cars, to water the golf course, or even to water off the garden. I don't think this is a human right. And if we do not understand that the water, which is a human right, is the smallest part of the water that we are using, and that the big parts, which can be, just to give you a figure, I mentioned we need about 25 liters per day per capita. Well, we are using in the United States about 400 liters per day. So this 380 liters of water, I don't think this is a human right, and this should have a price. Why? Because if we do not put a price, we will not make the investments which are necessary in order to use the most precious of the resources that we have in a more responsible manner. We cannot go on that we are losing in the developed countries. I'm speaking now about Europe, about the United States, that we are losing more than 30% of our water supply because we don't have sufficient infrastructure, because the infrastructure is completely deficient. It cannot be that we are losing 55, 60, 70% of the water supply in developing countries because all the tubes have huge leakages and the water is getting lost. We cannot continue to use the water and irrigation systems which are thousands of years old and are not being upgraded, and that we would therefore say that according to the OECD, we would need every single year an investment of $1 trillion just to keep up the infrastructure of the water supply. In reality, we are spending a little bit more than $500 billion, not even half of this. So the water situation gets worse and worse. And if we do not give a value to the water, those investments are not going to be made because nobody has an interest to invest because you don't have an economical return. If the value of water is zero, any investment will never yield. If the water has at least a decent price, an investment might yield. And that's why we don't make the investment. Those who emotionally appeal that water should not have any price because it is a human right, they don't look into reality. In those countries where there are not sufficient investments made in infrastructure, the one who are paying most for the water are the poorest of the country. If you look at the statistic, you will see that a rich person in New York pays about 10 to 15% the price for 1 cubic meter water than the poorest in Bangladesh or somewhere in India. And this is the injustice. This is when you don't give value to the water. It's not the rich that are paying the price. It's the poor who pay the highest price. Why? Because there is no infrastructure. Therefore, there is no fountain. Therefore, those poor people have to buy the water by big trucks. And the price of those trucks is about 6 to 8 times as much as what the normal water supply would be costing. So there is a completely misconception or a misreading of the reality by saying water is human right, therefore shouldn't have any price. Well, the outcome is that the poorest are paying even more. Or they have to walk like in Africa. The average walking time for ladies and for children is 6 hours per day in order to walk to the next fountain and to carry the 10-liter or 20-liter bag on their head home. Six hours on an average for every lady and the children in this country. This is what you get when water doesn't have a price.